My work is to produce energy from plants, and that's what we are going to do today. Also, I can describe you how to use your household plant to produce some electricity with simple ingredients that you should have at home.
You did hear that right. Dr. Fabio Meda, who's a scientist working at the Italian Institute for Technology, is showing me how to generate electricity from a houseplant. His laboratory's shut because of coronavirus, so he's using a webcam in his bedroom to demonstrate.
So, here I have a plant, of course.
What kind of plant is it?
That's a rhododendron plant. We are going to touch the plant leaf surface, so they shouldn't break too easily. Here I have the cable. It's very thin cables. And that's it, basically. Some LEDs.
Some LED light bulbs.
Exactly. Let's start. So first of all, you should connect the small needle into the inner plant tissue. Just punch it into the bark.
He drives a nail into the stem of the plant, ties that to the piece of wire, and then connects the wire to a row of green LEDs. The LEDs are stuck to the underside of a strip of silicon rubber. He takes the silicon and starts slapping it against one of the leaves of the plant.
Oh, yeah. Green light's coming on. I can see it. Oh, that's amazing.
People fixing the world.
Welcome to People Fixing the World from the BBC World Service. This is the programme that looks at unusual solutions to some of the world's problems. I'm Daniel Gordon, and in this edition, I'm looking at the power of nature. We're not even halfway through 2020, and it's already predicted by some scientists to be one of the hottest years since records began, if not the hottest. So the need to develop green sources of energy that could help tackle climate change is more urgent than ever. Could the answer be, well, everywhere? There are natural supplies of energy all around us. Some of them have already been put to use, and most people will be familiar with wind and solar power. But this program's not about them. It's about the energy that's in places you might not think of, like the heat trapped in rocks nearly 5 kilometres underground. And at all the points where rivers run into the sea and fresh water meets salty water. It turns out it even grows on plants and trees. I'm going to be meeting some of the people who hope that eventually they can harvest it and turn it into electricity so we can reduce our reliance on the fossil fuels that are driving global warming. One of those people is Fabian Mede, the man you heard a moment ago using his pot plant to generate electricity.
I mean, surely people must think you're crazy, you know? I mean, we've come up with this idea that you're going to generate electricity from trees. I mean, it's nuts, isn't it?
Let's say at the beginning, I myself didn't believe that this worked. So doing the first experiments in the laboratory, I could not believe that the signal is true. I was thinking, oh, there must be a mistake somewhere. But at the end, it was true. And starting also convincing myself, then I let's say, managed to convince also some of my friends, my family, whatever, about this. But still, they think we are crazy. So this is still part of a scientist's life, I guess, anyway.
Dr. Mede is part of a team of researchers who found out that this technique for generating electricity works on the leaves of any plant or tree that grows on dry land. It's not just rhododendrons in pots on your balcony. It's a natural phenomenon that occurs every time the wind blows hard enough to make two leaves touch each other.
This is the same mechanism that you might know from the rubber balloon, which you rub onto your clothes or on your hair, and it creates a static electricity on the surface.
Like so many scientific breakthroughs, Dr. Mede's team came across it by chance while they were working on another project.
The original idea is to produce energy from artificial bush and are moved by wind. The idea is also to use the wind generated by cars, you know, along the motorway. The principle is the same, but in this original idea, all is artificial, so there is no natural leaves.
That's Dr. Mede's colleague, Dr. Barbara Mazzolai. And it was when she was working on that artificial bush that she began to experiment on real plants, and that's when she realised they were effectively natural electrical generators.
If the two natural leaves are in contact, they produce energy, in fact, but the quantity of the energy produced in this way is very low, so we cannot power any artificial devices.
The solution she and her colleagues came up with was simple: to add artificial leaves to the tree made of conductive materials like silicon rubber.
These materials are very good when they are in contact with the natural leaves. So our idea is to create hybrid trees. This is the goal, to have several artificial and natural leaves that are moved by wind. And so in this way we can extract the energy from these leaves.
How is this different to a wind turbine? Because, I mean, you could just put up a wind turbine that also takes advantage of the wind and produces a lot more power.
It's different because the idea is to use a natural structure that are trees, in fact. So we don't need to add some big infrastructure in the environment.
But, I mean, on a typical tree, I mean, there must be thousands of leaves. That's a massive job, isn't it?
Absolutely, yes. We need time to, in some way, put the artificial leaves on the natural one, but it's still convenient.
And presumably you have to be careful about the plants that you choose. They've got to be evergreen trees, right, that you pick. Otherwise, in autumn, you've got no electricity.
Absolutely, at least you don't have in winter. So this is very important.
Before the coronavirus lockdown brought everything to a stop, the team at IIT managed to test a tree in a wind tunnel with seven artificial leaves attached to it, and each of them lit up 150 LEDs. But even if they managed to hook up every leaf in a whole tree, the amount of energy they could produce would still be relatively small. So realistically, they're hoping to use this system to generate just enough power to run the lights in a park, say, or the sensors used in agriculture to monitor the amount of heat and light that crops receive. There's still one big unanswered question, though. We don't know if trees use this energy for something themselves and what effect taking it away could have on them. And by the way, I did have a go at the plant slapping myself, but the lights just wouldn't come on for me.
I'm not sure if the plant will be happy for that.
Now it's time for our second natural power source. One of the issues with growing electricity on trees is something that affects lots of renewable energy sources. If the conditions aren't right, they don't work. So how about this?
There is still one little known yet powerful option: osmosis, also known as blue energy.
That's a promotional video made by a Swiss research laboratory, which is one of the many organisations around the world trying to develop so-called blue energy.
This is a very promising source of renewable energy. Solar panels only work when the sun shines, and wind turbines when the wind blows. But osmosis can be used in river estuaries, where fresh water meets seawater, and could potentially work all the time.
The fresh river water obviously gets more and more salty until eventually it turns into seawater. Scientists know that this very simple chemical change releases energy. What they're working out now is the best way to harness it and turn it into a viable electricity supply. As you're about to hear, the technique is still being refined, but the basic idea is to divert the water into a power plant and let it mix there under controlled conditions. The salt water and the fresh water are pumped in separately. They're allowed to mix in a huge container inside, which has a membrane, like a very fine sheet, strung across the middle of it, right at the point where the two types of water meet. And it's the membrane that's used to generate electricity. I spoke to two of the researchers who've been trying to develop the idea.
Well, hello, my name is Martina Lichter.
Hey, my name is Michał Macha.
They work at the EPFL laboratory in Switzerland.
it's quite stunning that it's possible to produce the energy from this kind of sources. Like, it's very renewable source of energy, it doesn't pollute, doesn't produce CO2, and basically it could be available 24/7.
I mean, it sounds a bit too good to be true. Why has nobody thought to capitalize on this before?
So actually this idea exists already for like 70 years. And yeah, people were trying to extract this energy in different ways.
In fact, it was in 2009 that the world's first osmotic power plant opened in Norway, run by Statkraft.
The world needs more energy, pure energy.
And here's their promo video.
If fresh and salt water are separated by a membrane, the fresh water will travel through the membrane to equal out the difference in salinity. This will increase the pressure on the seawater side, corresponding to lifting the water 120 meters. The pressurized water can be used to run a turbine that generates electricity.
But that plant closed down after 4 years because its operators couldn't produce electricity cheaply enough to make it worthwhile. At the lab where Martina and Michal are based, they've gone back to the drawing board, using a different technique to the one tried in Norway. They've adapted the membrane that separates the salt water and fresh water. Instead of causing pressure to build up that then drives a turbine, as the water mixes, the membrane acts as a kind of filter that separates out the ions, the tiny particles that make up the salt in the water, into positive and negative ones.
This kind of membrane should prevent one type of ion, for example, positively charged ions, not to go through on the other side, while only the negatively charged ions will be able to pass. And in this way, you will have this kind of a net charge. You can extract this, we call it osmotic current, which can be then converted into the electrical current.
And the crucial thing is to find the right material to make the membrane with.
The membrane needs to be able to carry an electrical charge. It needs to be tough enough that it can stay intact while holes are drilled all over its surface to allow the water to pass through. And it also needs to be very thin so it won't slow down the flow of water.
The material they've come up with is a substance called molybdenum disulfide. It occurs naturally in crystals, and they've managed to produce a layer of it that's just 3 atoms thick. And whilst it might have a fancy chemical name, the first method they tried to file it down until it was almost invisible involved some full-on low-tech.
How do you make something so thin? How do you manage to thin it down that much?
We can exfoliate it. We can thin it down to very thin size. For example, you can use the, let's say, just the ordinary sticky tape.
The actual sticky tape?
Yes, yes, exactly. You press this sticky tape to the crystal and you peel it off, and then you will see that you have some pieces of this material on the sticky tape. And then by folding the sticky tape to each other and unfolding and doing this many, many times, you can extract these very thin layers.
Since then, the team has managed to reproduce the same material in the lab, which means it's easier to make large sheets of it. They've also found that shining a light on the membrane as the fluids mix could boost energy production. But so far, they've only tested their system under laboratory conditions. And although they've proved it works, they've managed to produce just a tiny amount of electricity using a small piece of membrane with a single minuscule hole in it called a nanopore, just big enough to allow a salt ion to pass through. Michal admits that there's a long way to go before this can be scaled up.
We have made only one pore in this nanomaterial. From that, we have estimated how much power we can get if we made a lot of pores. So you can imagine that we have a super thin membrane, super thin film suspended like between one water and other water reservoirs, right? And now you want to make a lot of holes in it. You want to make it even more fragile than it is. It's a challenge. I mean, we are taking the physics to extremes, yes.
There's still a lot of work to do to turn this tiny patch of membrane into a fully functioning power station. Pumping the river and seawater to the power station takes energy, for example. And then before you can use it, you have to filter the water.
You know, natural water is filled with particles with stuff that you don't want to have on your membrane, because they will clog the membrane, they can destroy the membrane. So yeah, this is actually a huge art by itself to figure out how to overcome this. You can either try to have some design tricks, or you can try to make your membranes basically so efficient that you don't have to worry about the energy losses.
With so much still to work out, it sounds like it's going to be quite some time until blue energy is able to live up to its potential. That's if it ever does. Meanwhile, under our feet, there's another potential power supply. It's absolutely vast and pretty much inexhaustible. Geothermal energy, using heat from the molten core of the Earth as a power source, is nothing new. There are loads of geothermal plants running in more than 20 countries around the world, which use hot rock underground to produce steam, which in turn spins turbines to create electricity. Kenya, for example, already gets a quarter of its energy from underground. Standard geothermal wells are between 1.5 and 2.5 kilometers below the surface, and the rocks there are normally no hotter than 350 degrees C. But there's a race to go deeper and hotter with something called deep geothermal. One of the people involved is Gudmundur Omar Friedlifsson at the Iceland Deep Drilling Project. He's dug down to double that and says the rewards are potentially a lot bigger.
Our mission is to drill into very deep hole into very hot rocks. And we have set our targets to rocks that are at below 3 kilometer depth, down to approximately 5 kilometers. And the rock temperature we are after is about 400 degrees centigrade and up to 600 degrees. It costs about three times more than a conventional well. But if you can utilize it, tame it, shall we say, control it, then we could expect to get, say, 10 times more energy out of each drill hole. So in the long run, you will learn from it.
But it also comes with bigger risks, like what happened when they were digging their first well.
At 2,100 or 2.1 kilometer with magma, unexpectedly, which was 900 degree hot. And that was some experience, I tell you. We got a kick from the magma, so the drill string which was down into the hole, it was kicked upwards.
Sorry, what you're calling a kick? I mean, what in reality, what does that feel like?
It is just like somebody down there in the ground is pushing up against you.
They stopped drilling and moved to another well instead, but then the same thing happened again. On the third attempt, they drilled into magma yet again. But this time, they decided to just keep going.
We drilled the third time to the same depth, got the kick, but very obstinate, stay put. Just pumping water through the drill bit and say, "We shall tame you." And we put down some pipes and just cemented the pipe to the inner casing, shall we say, and half a year after the drilling, we started producing from the well. We did some testing for almost 3 years until 2012. Learned a lot about how to deal with magma at shallow depth in high temperature fields.
After that, the magma well was sealed off, and the team moved on to the second phase of the project, a 4.5 kilometer deep hole that was completed in 2017.
How long does it take to dig that deep beneath the earth?
168 days, to be exact.
Is that continuously, you mean 24 hours?
Yes.
So that's one long drill bit. I mean, that's not something you can store in your shed?
No, no, no. There are many, many drill bits. So this is a technique that is well known in the oil industry and in the drilling business. So nothing special about that.
Why wasn't this tried before?
Because people were not convinced that they could control it, such very hot fluid. in natural environment.
And what makes you think you can now?
Better technique and more curiosity.
I should say that although geothermal energy is very green, some greenhouse gases can escape from underground. Still, the climate footprint is much, much lower than for fossil fuels. The important thing for Gudmundur is that the Iceland deep drilling project has demonstrated that it's possible to handle the extreme conditions deep underground. An earlier attempt to dig to this kind of depth in Switzerland had to be abandoned after it triggered an earthquake, and the geologist behind it was prosecuted for damaging property. But as you might have picked up, Gudmundur is not someone who gets discouraged easily, and he says he's not worried.
We would not be concerned about such a small earthquake, 3.4 on Richter scale. But people that are not used to earthquakes of this magnitude, especially if it is sort of inside town, you can feel it and people are just scared of it. And of course, that is very uncomfortable. So I can understand the fear there. But in our case, we are drilling in a remote an inhabited area, 15 kilometers to the nearest village. So these earthquakes would not be felt at all there.
Iceland already gets a lot of its energy from traditional geothermal sources because it lies above a ridge where two tectonic plates meet. So there's more heat closer to the surface than in other places. But it's not the only country that sits above geological fault lines. And so, in theory, deep geothermal wells like the one Gudmundur has been working on could also be constructed in places like Indonesia, Turkey, Italy and Kenya, all of which already use conventional geothermal energy.
So far we are just in this research and development. So we have not reached that stage to make it economical. So it's a long-term research project. That could have very high reward or return.
That's it from People Fixing the World this week. We love getting your emails, so please get in touch if you've seen projects you think we should cover or you just want to say hello. The email is peoplefixingtheworld@bbc.co.uk.